Hello, and welcome. In today's video, we're going to talk about the new PlayStation 3 emulator that arrived on Android and all the controversies surrounding it. The emulator appeared, sparked a lot of discussion, and has already disappeared from the scene. We'll test some games and also talk about other PS3 emulation projects that already exist. All that right after a word from our sponsors. If you want to buy original games while saving a lot, check out Instant Gaming, the digital store that sells games for various platforms, such as PC, PlayStation, Xbox, and Nintendo Switch. Get games of all genres with discounts of up to 95%. You'll also find a variety of gift cards and credits for other services. You can pay for your order through your credit card on a website with a 4.7 rating on Trustpilot. You're buying games directly from Instant Gaming, not from other retailers. If you encounter any issues, Instant Gaming offers 24/7 support. Get the highly acclaimed Hogwarts Legacy now, in its base version for $11.44, and the deluxe version for $14.15. Check out the price comparison with Steam's pricing. What are you waiting for to save? There's no way to start without talking about the controversy this emulator generated, even before presenting any results. It appeared on GitHub with a controversial proposal, asking for $5,000 to release the source code. This sparked a huge debate in the community because what the developer was essentially doing was taking RPCS3, an open source project, packaging it into an APK, and redistributing it as if it were an authentic piece of work, while also charging for access to a modification of open source software. The backlash was immediate, and major figures in the scene started criticizing the developer's actions. It's possible he managed to raise some money before disappearing. Those who contributed were left with an unfinished version, full of performance issues and lacking support for external controllers. But when you think about it, who is really to blame in this situation? I'll leave that for you to reflect on and draw your own conclusions. What I bring here are just the facts. The most qualified team to port RPCS3 to Android would be the RPCS3 team itself. However, they've made it clear that they have no intention of doing so because they consider the Android community toxic. At the same time, Android has grown into a massive market that is hard to ignore, with more and more native releases, such as Grid Legends and Bright Memory Infinity. Another project worth mentioning is Olympus, developed by a Brazilian. However, its setup process is extremely complex. Even when following detailed tutorials, there's still a high chance that nothing will work correctly. And even if everything does work, you need to connect a keyboard or use third-party apps to simulate a touchscreen controller. Now think about it, you're in a public place, wanting to play a PS3 game, and you need to connect a keyboard to your phone? Not practical at all. As I always say on this channel, an emulator needs to be simple to configure. Within minutes, the user should be playing their favorite games, without having to install dependencies via terminal or spend hours researching solutions, only to end up with a frustrating experience full of crashes and inaccurate emulation. That's where APS3 comes in. It did what Olympus couldn't. It packaged Olympus into a ready-to-use APK, complete with functional touch controls, eliminating the need for external apps. This seemed promising, just a few more implementations, graphical optimizations, and it could have become the best option for playing PS3 games on Android. But then comes the question, how do you monetize the work involved in this process? The APS3E developer tried to charge $5,000 to release the code and allow others to improve the project or create forks. The problem is that most emulators follow an open source license, which means they can't be sold. The community reacted and pressured the developer. Even members of the RPCS3 and CME teams were there, leaving comments and demanding that he at least release the portions of the code derived from open source projects. In response, he lowered the goal to $2,000. But on February 19, when this script was written, the APS3 GitHub page was taken down. All signs point to the RPCS3 team taking action since the project was violating the open source license. If you contributed to the project in any way, you definitely lost your money. That's why, when everyone was talking about this emulator, I chose to wait a bit longer. Just like I'm waiting to talk about a Nintendo Switch project for iOS. In reality, it would be interesting for the community to create a guide on which emulators are unreliable and the reasons why I came to that conclusion. Who guarantees that this type of application cannot collect your data or contain some kind of malware? This has already happened many times, especially after Yuzu was taken down by Nintendo. But if you still decide to trust this emulator and want to know about its features, let's test it and present the results. First, it is necessary to edit the configuration files. I have already prepared a file for replacement, which will bring more stability to the games and prevent various issues. To replace it, simply access the device root, open the APS3 folder, select the config folder, and replace the config.yml file. Regarding my recording setup, I always need to clarify for new subscribers. I use a capture card, so the tests are not affected by recording software. If you want to learn more about this, check out the video I recommend after this one. And before we start the tests, don't forget to leave a like to help with engagement. Videos like this take a lot of work to produce, and if it's your first time on the channel, consider subscribing. Now, let's get to my impressions. I downloaded more than 15 games, totaling over 80 gigabytes of data. However, right away, I encountered a critical bug. The emulator does not allow the installation of games larger than 5 gigabytes, regardless of the format, whether PKG or ISO. Not even extracting the files on a PC and manually copying them to the emulator folder solves this problem. Additionally, while testing on the ROG phone, I noticed that sometimes it refuses to run certain games properly or presents visual issues that other devices do not have, especially on Vita 3K. But with this emulator, it was even worse. Most of the games that other creators managed to run simply do not start on my device. Out of the 15 games tested, only one worked, Terraria. At the moment, the emulator does not support keys in the wrap format, so the game only ran in its demo version. But within this limitation, the performance was acceptable. This is exactly why I don't like testing emulators in early stages or extremely complicated projects. The information becomes vague, with little to showcase, and can end up creating false expectations. This project seemed doubtful to me from the start, so I waited longer than usual to talk about it. I always prefer to show something more solid. The issues I faced probably happened because I tested the games on Vulkan instead of OpenGL, which is the project's default API. If you encounter difficulties, try switching between APIs. Regarding the project's future, on February 20th, the developer updated the official page, which is hosted on a Chinese website and receiving so much traffic that it is slow. He states that this is a free project, with no monetization or ads, developed for the long term. However, he mentions that he needs financial support to continue. He also said that the project had been in development since January, and that he resumed it now because it received more media attention. Additionally, he guarantees that he does not intend to violate any GPL license or keep the code closed, but emphasizes that financial support is necessary. Whether it's worth investing in this project or not is a decision only you can make. And it's not over yet. To put an end to this story, Jared, the developer of Sudachi, launched a new project on GitHub called RPCS3 Droid. According to the description, it is an attempt to run RPCS3 natively via Android Studio. At the moment, it is still not possible to compile builds, and there is already a notice on the project stating that contributions will not be accepted. Any related pull requests will be closed. At the very least, he properly credited the RPCS3 license. Now, the question remains, do you think Jared will have time to manage Sudachi, Folium, and the other Mac projects he's involved in addition to porting RPCS3 to Android? And if he manages to do it, will the results be minimally satisfactory? Will we finally have an APK that can be installed normally, without having to be a true computer science PhD to make it run, like what happens with Olympus? Leave your thoughts in the comments. And that's it for the video. Thank you for your audience, and see you in the next one.